Stephanie's not up and running?
Yeah.
I'm going to call the order of the Salisbury Board of Education meeting, October 28th, 2013. Looking for an approval of the agenda.
I would just add there, just a brief update on the wellness council's doings.
And the new business?
Or old business.
Old business, wellness council.
I'll second that.
Who made the motion?
You need me.
And I would like to make a motion to add under new business the secretary's responsibility about answering the phone in the main office.
Is this the best place to discuss that?
Where do you want to discuss it? Under old business?
I don't know. It seems like something you might want to talk to the principal about without necessarily having it in the public. I mean, you've already done that, and now we need to talk about it publicly.
I guess if it's a concern.
Well, whatever you want to do. I just have an issue with it, so.
I would suggest maybe principal first, because it might be something that's just resolved, depending on the roles. If it changes the responsibilities to the extent that it impacts the budget, then it would come back to this group in some way.
Okay.
That's where I would start. Is that fair?
Fine with me. But we will have that discussion.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Motion's been made and seconded, including the wellness committee update. Any other discussion?
Well, Amy made an... Okay, sorry, go ahead.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? So carried. Minutes of July 15th, 2013. Regular meeting.
Now, did we just not approve that because you weren't in there in August and we just sort of forgot? Just,
yeah.
Okay. I move we approve the minutes of the July 15th, 2013 meeting. Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? So carried. The minutes of September 23rd, 2013 regular meeting.
I wanted to just make one addition. Where was it here? And that was just, we talked about, where we requested, there was a couple of us who requested digital rather than paper reports. And I didn't see that in the minutes.
Do you remember when that was discussed?
Probably under principal's report, because it was a big packet, maybe 10 papers. And just
mine,
and yours,
I think we did that too.
Both.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was both.
I remember that discussion.
I think it happened.
I think
it did happen.
No, but Amy, I usually don't finish mine till the day of the meeting. I'm sorry. I mean, I try and get it done before then, but it's just really hard. I can send it to you right before we come over.
I just think it's a great model to strive for. All I'm saying is I would like to, it was brought up, we talked about it at the board meeting, but it's not in the minutes.
Not in the minutes.
So whether or not it's doable, that's a different story.
Where do you want it in the minutes?
I think under principal's report, at the end.
Yeah, it's fact-checking things till just before we got down here, so.
Mm-hmm. So we have a motion to approve the minutes as amended.
So moved.
Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Who seconded?
That is
Clark.
Opposed? Abstentions? So carried. Financial report, Sue.
Not a lot to report since the September meeting. Did make a very similar, or actually the exact same report to the Board of Finance on the 10th at their quarterly meeting. I did point out to them a couple of items. On the first page, you may notice that under the substitutes line, we have expensed quite a bit more so far this year than we had at this time last year. And that is simply a matter of where I'm paying Jen Zagala, who's team teaching with Carolyn Dean while she's working a part-time schedule. I'm paying Jen out of the subline, and we've also have Ed Dunce on board now as our full-time permanent sub that's also being paid out of the subline. I'm anticipating that at the end of the year, it's all going to balance out because of savings in the certified salary line. So we don't have to worry about that part of the budget being over. It will all balance itself out.
So is Karen officially working half-time?
I mean, she's working 3 days a week.
She works 3 days a week.
But that's something.
Some weeks, and then other weeks she's here 5 days. They right. sort of figure out where they are and how her schedule can work within that.
Okay.
On the second page under the 4,000 educational supplies line, you'll notice that the math, and I don't remember if I mentioned this in September or not, the math line is over by $3,000. The number that we put in the budget was an estimate given to us by central office based on what they thought we were going to need in the way of materials. Lisa decided during the summer to include the fourth and fifth grade in the changeover to investigations, which we hadn't talked about at budget time. So sort of those two reasons combined is why that line is over. And the science line is over due to a one-time purchase of a piece of equipment that John Conklin needed, actually two pieces of equipment that he needed for his trout tank. That was an unexpected purchase that he needed, something to do with the air supply, the filtration system. The summer projects came through, many of them under budget. So I think in the 5,000, 5,100 and 5,200 series, we're in very good shape. We've only had, knock on wood, a couple of unexpected little repairs at the end of the summer, but nothing like last year. We just today signed a contract for the Gator.
Utility vehicle.
So that's on its way to completion.
And did that come in where we expected it to be? Did we decide to finance it?
Right around, yes. Yeah. And that about. Joe Cleveland has set up all of the paperwork and everything for the financing of the bank. And hopefully we'll get it before the first big snowfall.
And was that close to what we had guessed back in the spring that it would cost, or was it less because we?
I don't think it's less. It's not less. It's a little bit more, but it's yeah. on the yeah. right on the money in terms of what.
We, yeah, off the top of my head, $30,474.15, mm-hmm. I believe is the number. Mm-hmm. So
we budgeted 27.
Well, we budgeted for a five-year payback based at 5,800 a year or something.
I also added a paper on the tables, an update of the capital reserve, which I also gave to the Board of Finance on October 10th. If you look at our January 30th, 2013 balance and add to that the $25,000 from the 12-13 budget and our estimated surplus for 12-13, we would have just shy of $400,000 in available funds in that account. And through all the projects that were completed this summer, we spent just under $214,000. Seven out of the 14 safety projects were completed. Three of them are in the process of being completed. And then there were four projects that there was going to be more research and discussion before they got started. And those four outstanding projects are estimating about $80,000. So we're in very good shape as far as still having money left in that capital reserve account for an emergency or something.
The clock's up and running?
Yes. I think he's waiting for a couple of replacement clocks.
There are only about two.
They're supposed to come this week.
But they're not. One's in the office that I use down in middle school, so it's not a, such a big deal. Disrupting any teaching.
Any other questions for Sue? Thank you, Sue.
You're welcome.
School-related organizations. Region 1 representative. Do you have anything that would be appropriate from you?
The budget passed.
The budget passed.
Thank you to everybody that voted.
Yep.
Thank you very much. Just, I can do some highlights of that meeting quickly if you like.
Sure.
Mr. Strieber presented a PowerPoint on the use of data and how data is used at the high school. He informed the board that security cameras have been installed and they're continuing their work on security. They're working with the state police as well. In a proactive fashion, he's continued the peer leadership program that was started last year, working with students. He's activated the technology committee to meet and discuss ways of which to go in the future with technology at the high school, and they'll continue that until we have a solution. I don't know if you recall, but the Region 1 board had also asked CREC to come in and do a study, not only of the infrastructure, but really a look at 101 and how the better avenue to take with 101, or if they choose not to go 101 and just remain with a more traditional lab sort of setting. So that's coming up. They have not done that study at this time. Chloe O'Kane was a recipient of the National Merit Scholar Commendation, so we're excited about that. Under new business, a new business, a new teacher was hired in special education replacement teacher, Mrs. Amanda Bunting. She has been assigned by Pupil Services at Kent Center School. And the social studies field trip was approved to West Point. There was an executive session to discuss two items, a pending litigation and also the new school administrator's contract. The board then moved back into open session and voted to approve and ratify the Region 1 Federation of School Administrators contract.
And that's the principal?
Principal, assistant principal, and the director of pupil services and the supervisor of special education. It's a four-member unit.
Any written communications? Any oral communications? Mr. Rollins.
I just wanted to say that for my tenure on the board, it was a pleasure serving with Amy, Brian, and Jennifer. Congratulations on moving on, and good luck in everything you do, and thank you for all you've done for Salisbury Central School.
Thank you. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brian.
Anyone else?
I just had one. I've been talking to a lot of people the past few weeks. And I had someone come up to me the other day and say, a teacher from another district, not Region 1, actually she's up in New York, just tell me how happy she was that we were going to investigations, because she as a teacher has found it to be a terrific math program. And you know, she explained the various things to me, which were all like way over my head, but why she liked it so much better than the other things that are out there. And you know, she didn't think Chicago math was terrible, or whatever it's called. Was terrible, but she, you know, it had these issues and these issues and these issues, and she really just thinks investigations is going to be a better product for all of us. So I thought that was encouraging.
Mm-hmm. We think so too.
Principal's report, Lisa.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for that segue.
Speaking of math,
I will say that in the course of doing my usual categories of discussion here and in curriculum and discussion, I would say we're pretty much status quo from last time in terms of our main areas of focus in the elementary school are certainly getting up to speed with the investigations program, and I'll talk in a minute about the PD that we did in October around that, but I will echo what Jennifer has said, that teachers are thrilled about it. I think they feel that the problem-solving aspect is much more interesting than other math programs. The use of sort of manipulative different ways to come at problem-solving, the discussion of all of the different ways to arrive at an answer as opposed to just memorizing a standard algorithm, I think is much more engaging for students. And I think when they do finally get to those standard algorithms, they will make much more sense to the students, and they get there later, much later in time. English language arts, we have now regional assessments that will take place three times a year from grades K to 8 that are aligned with the Common Core, which means they will address the narrative form of writing, the informational form of writing, and the argumentative, what we used to call the space of writing. And so I think teachers are happy to have have that task finished and then to be able to then begin to use those assessments. We had our first round of data teams, and I'll just briefly say that I think our teachers are becoming much, much more skilled at addressing skills. They're not looking at response to intervention as being, oh, I didn't teach this lesson well, I have to go back and teach the student. They're being able to really identify a skill set that different students may be deficit in, and then really develop intervention strategies that go over a period of weeks that where they can start to track and progress monitor data and make corrections or make adjustments along the way. And the discussions were really great. We're doing our first report cards in PowerSchool for the middle school this quarter. They may not have all of the information that we have had on report cards in the past. I don't know that we'll have comments, but there will be grades. And Pam will write a little disclaimer at the bottom that says this is a work in progress. And we'll have a complete report card, or one that has all the information by the next quarter. Staff management and development is really, I would say, has been the focus of attention for the teachers and for me for October. It has been a heroic effort to get teachers up to speed with the teacher evaluation system. I'm sure Amy can echo any experience that she's had there. But coming to grips with these student learning objectives is a real sea change for teachers. I'm sorry. If I can get a glass of water, that would be great. Understanding what that means and making sure that they're good goals, that it's not just conversation and it's not just some sort of paper chase that we go through. And so that's time consuming for the teachers, and it's been time consuming for me, but it's been all very good. And I can't say how great our teachers have been. They have embraced it. They've seen this as a positive move to really being able to validate the good work that they've been doing.
I would just add, if I could, Lisa, maybe catch your breath a bit. Mm-hmm. I would add that the teachers have always had goals, but I think what's significantly different is that they're tied now to student outcomes specifically.
Right.
I mean, they've always had goals, and
that's just kidding.
Thank you.
And this is sort of an opportunity to look at them a little differently, but we haven't lost track of sort of the whole child and what needs to have happened otherwise. So we're working that on multiple angles, and they have opportunities to do that. So it's not just about a test, for instance.
And I did want to thank you, Patricia, and I did want to thank you and Diane for putting together the workshop that we had for all of the teachers. I think that was helpful. Mm-hmm. Somebody came from the state, so you know, we brought the mountain to us, and they were able to answer everybody's questions. And I think did a great service in calming some anxiety in talking about the fact that we're all in this, and this is a pilot experience for all of us.
I think the anxiety came with the deadline so quick. After that workshop, it was just too short a time frame to do the labor intensity required of writing a good SLO.
Right.
Yeah.
And what I've been doing as we've worked through this process, we're making notes about what's working, and clearly we have to move that deadline. We have to move it to about mid-month at least. We found that out. So mm-hmm. We're learning.
Time for collaboration between or across schools mm-hmm. would be wonderful, especially for people who are the only person in their department, which is quite common in the middle school of our six towns. So,
and we talked about that at the last administrative.
Yeah, putting heads together and working together and collaboratively throughout the region rather than just in our own schools.
And this format really lends itself to doing that, mm-hmm. So I think that's a really good idea. And then we had great PD days, the 10th and the 11th. They were all focused on curriculum development at a sort of a regional level. We had a fabulous consultant come in from investigations, Alicia O'Neill, and she will be coming back again in January. And really connected with all the teachers, and I think it will help them understand the philosophy of the program. And I think quelled some of their expectations.
Thank you, Deb.
Thank you. really quelled a lot of their expectations in terms of alignment with Common Core. So We're really excited to have her back in January. The other workshops were really to look at curriculum as it relates, not only to the Common Core, but to update, refresh assessments. What is it that we're expecting students to know and be able to do? I think the middle school spent quite a lot of time in English language arts, science, and social studies looking at literacy across the curriculum and having some good discussions there.
It was mostly about the writing assessments. Mm-hmm. We focused on those. Mm-hmm.
And math continued, there weren't middle school math continued their work there. School climate, we have completed the climate survey, although just on Friday, and I really haven't had time to look at the look closely at the results. I can tell you some early returns. We had 82 parents participate, and I think we have about 180 families. We have 280 students, but about 180 families. So less than 50% there.
Lisa, just with regard to that, I have two kids in the school, and I did it once, didn't go back to do it a second time. There mm-hmm. wasn't a choice to say, to allow you to name more than one child. So that mm-hmm. may be, you know, if people have multiple kids, why the numbers were low, because
no, but you only wanted
one. So that's 82, we have about 180 families.
But you were only supposed to fill it out once.
Yeah.
Right, and that's what I did. Right. But I mean, something might apply to, I mean, it was asking, does your child mm-hmm. experience blah, blah, like it's asking you, what grade is your child in? What's the sex of the child?
Right.
So it was specific to that right. child. And so one child may have a completely different experience than another child in the family.
Wondering
and in my case, that wasn't,
but
I was
yeah.
noticing that as I was filling it out, thinking, I wonder, you know.
Oh, you mean some people might not have filled it out because they might have felt, I can't answer this because...
Or they might have just filled it out for one child, and maybe they filled it out on the child who's having a more negative experience, or perhaps filled it out on the child who's having a more positive experience or something. So just, you know, for future reference,
well,
there may be something.
But that's my point. We have 280 students and 180 families. So we had 82...
Of the 180.
Of the 180.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
That responded.
Which isn't, I mean...
That's and that's bad. Pretty. That's
I mean,
pretty.
Right.
Good.
That's
pretty. Yeah.
Right. Right. But as I was going through it, I was just yeah. thinking, is it?
But
know?
I did notice that, and yeah. that would be something that I think needs that would be feedback that I bring to the state when we.
Because we can't correct that. They have to correct it.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah.
Well, the other thing was, and you may be getting to this, but Claude and I happened to be here for one of the, I don't remember what they were called, parent.
Focus groups.
Yeah. And. You got some interesting, I mean, there were some interesting discussions. I don't know whether you thought the information was useful or not, but I thought it was interesting.
It was very useful. I mean, we had only 7 parents that came, and we had 4 different meetings.
Wow.
So
But those 7 were over two.
Right.
Two meetings you had nobody, right?
Yes. On the first day we had nobody. So then I sent out another reminder, and the second day we had 7. And I thought it was all very good discussion. And the
just gives you a place to start, and, you know, see
yeah.
how widely relevant it is.
And I've sort of done a cursory look at the open-ended questions, and there are certainly already have a lot of ideas and things that we can do to, you know, develop a plan and address those issues. But by and large, it looks like people are pretty satisfied with the experience that their children are having. And so, in my opinion, we only have to go up, you
right.
know, and
right.
and I think that's good news. But I will have a more in-depth analysis to share with you at the next board meeting. And we are continuing to work on the plan, which may not be done until closer to December. Technology, the iPad carts have been delivered in each school, and the teachers are starting to use them. We have these Tech Tuesdays where they're coming in and asking questions about how to use the iPad, PowerSchool, among other things, and they're being very well attended. I think the thing that Pam and I are really focusing on, though, is where do you find that professional development that's going to take teachers out of this sort of substitution or augmentation that they're not using the iPad to be a projector
mm-hmm.
or a so it replaces the paper, but to really redefine how they're doing instruction. And some teachers are sort of embracing that very readily. I know in the social studies, I was in there in the eighth grade classroom today, and they were making attack campaign videos of the, you know, Jefferson campaign. And they were putting music in, and you know, it was all it was all very good work. So, you know, I think teachers are going to be in varying levels of development with that, but Pam and I are really looking for something good that's going to help them get there. And I think until we do that, it will not be clear exactly where we go with the iPad technology.
Is that something being looked at regionally for all the schools in terms of, I don't know if Gonzo, and I heard Gonzo's name come up and mm-hmm. Sharon, is he able to give that sort of, or is it not, that's not what you're looking for?
I know, I prefer not to talk about that now.
Okay.
I mean, I've had some feedback about the kind of training that he's given, and I don't know that it's really that redefinition kind
okay,
of.
Right. I guess really my question is, regionally, is that what other schools?
I don't know.
To source that amongst everybody would be good.
It would be great mm-hmm. to be able to do that. I went to a conference last spring at UConn, and I'd like to tap into some of the resources that I saw there and see if we can't figure out a way to get them to come here. And if we did, I'm sure there'd be a price tag attached to it.
So
it would be very good to be able to share that regionally. But I think that's really what has to happen is that this technology becomes valuable if it allows teachers to do some really exciting things that they can't otherwise do.
Right.
Otherwise, they're going to be reluctant to take what they know, abandon what they know and what they know works, to just substitute it with a piece of technology.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see, Power School. We have reached out to the central office, and they have very graciously started to lend us support with the implementation there. We have a consultant from CRAC who's starting to help all of the IT and support staff so that we will hopefully get through our learning curve faster there. Athletics, our soccer teams had a great season and they had a lot of fun. The girls had a perfect season,
wow.
10 wins, no losses, and one tie.
Wow.
The boys are rebuilding, we had a new coach. Kudos to Brendan Riley, stepped up to the plate. He was really enthusiastic and wonderful. The boys won 3 games and lost 4, but they got the good sportsmanship award at the BCD tournament.
Yay.
And they just had fun. I mean, Brendan, he would come off the field and just look very, very happy with everything. So my congratulations to all of them, and thank you to Tracy and to Brendan for all their hard work.
And kudos to Brendan, too, who I saw at the Connecticut Council for Social Studies Conference.
Yeah.
He got a scholarship and went for free, so
nice.
That was wonderful.
Yeah, he was
yes.
very
yeah.
excited
yeah.
about that.
Great.
And then we have our usual plethora of activities. They had a reverse trick-or-treat today, so they went and distributed all the candy. There's food.
Who had that up? That's fantastic.
PTO does the
collecting.
Candy drive, and then the student council went.
They
dressed up in costumes, and they went house to house and gave out the candy.
I saw them down there. I wondered what was happening at that giant pizza slice house
in
the road. Not on the crosswalk.
That was Paul Denza and
I saw the
Brendan organized that.
So they were
with
reverse trick-or-treating.
Yeah.
Is that fair trade? Is that what that was?
No, they were handing out candy to them.
Distributing the candy to all the
okay.
neighbors. Yeah.
They can give it out on.
Okay, now
yeah.
there's another one called reverse trick-or-treating that educates people about fairly traded chocolate. And
oh.
it's called reverse trick-or-treating, where you give the house owner a piece of fairly traded chocolate and urge
cool.
them to think about
fair
you know, the ethics of what we eat.
Well, that's kind mm-hmm. of interesting.
That is neat.
Put that down for next year. then tomorrow we have our exciting food for thought. Amy, do you want to talk about that?
Oh, okay, then we can eliminate me from the other part. Unfortunately, after we had scheduled this date, which we checked, you know, the school calendar, make sure nothing else was going on. Turns out there's a town meeting scheduled that got scheduled after we had set this.
Oh,
date.
That's for the firehouse.
For the
yeah.
firehouse, the former firehouse,
yeah.
and how it's to be used. But anyway, we are hoping to get a core of very interested people to come to this Food for Thought that's going to be hosted by our committee, Lisa and Emily Armstrong-Verto, who is just a wonderfully engaging and excited and knowledgeable person to lead a conversation about what's possible in terms of food in our schools. And so we're hoping to build a core group of really committed folks who would explore the topic of what is possible this year and then report back to Lisa and the board on some recommendations they come up with. So
But dinner's still being served?
Dinner is served.
Okay.
Joe is,
chill, just people shut
Joe
up.
Is serving dinner, right? Being chicken chili and rice. Yes.
Yes.
Right. Tomorrow night, it starts at 6:30, so you could actually come and start a conversation and have dinner and then go to the town meeting afterwards.
Unless you have hockey practice, yes.
Yeah.
I'm not going to read all of the rest of these. I would encourage you to come to PTO game night for those of you who have children in the school. I think, Claude, I think you went last year. Did Beth, maybe you went last year. It's a really fun night. Where the Wild Things Are is coming, to is coming from Hotchkiss to us next Monday.
Oh,
Max
yeah.
Flemma, who used to go to school here, wrote a 10-minute play. Oh, Where the Wild Things Are was their summer read. And so... he wrote a play, and Amy Krasner-Kulo offered to bring it here, so it's coming on Monday afternoon at 2:30.
Nice.
Donna Bagley is putting together her annual Veterans Day Assembly, and we have a mystery guest speaker, some more. It's the relative of our staff. So. And parent-teacher conferences, November 13th and 14th, and a couple of field trips.
Knife sharpening?
Knife sharpening, yes. You can come and get
don't
your knife
bring it to
sharpened.
School, though.
It's a PTO activity.
And it's on Saturday. Just wanted to end by thanking Brian, Jennifer, and Amy for all of your support since I have come into this role. It's really been great working with you. And I wish you the best of luck in whatever you go to do next. And I hope I get to work with you in some capacity again in the future. It's been great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I add one more announcement just
sure.
to get this? Before parent-teacher conferences on the 13th, the Board of Ed typically holds, provides dinner for the teachers. So all of the board members are welcome to attend. The new board members will be elected November 5th. I'll make sure that they're invited to it as well. I don't know what we're eating.
Leftover waste.
Our community access our cable advisory council, so I don't think I'll be able to attend.
Okay. That's true.
It might just be getting over.
Yeah.
I don't know. We haven't finalized the time, but it's the field trip night.
True.
Thank you, Lisa. Superintendent's report, Tricia.
Thank you very much. I believe, I hope this isn't a complete repeat for last month. I have not written my November report. You'll get my November report in November. But take a quick peek through. If there's any questions that you have, I'm happy to answer them. I also included in this packet this month the legislative summary. We are only going to address the ones that are appropriate to Salisbury Central School. There's many here that they speak about alliance schools. Alliance schools in the state of Connecticut are 30 schools that have been identified as low performing schools. So if you see something in here about an alliance school, it doesn't apply to us. Also, they talk about community schools. They use that term differently. Even though we are a community school, you're not in the state's mm-hmm. eyes a community school, so we do not have to adhere to the legislation that's specific to community schools. So there's a lot of information there. We're going to continue to bring the policies forward like we have, sort of one at a time. After we have a new board intact, we'll be talking about how they want to proceed with policy. Some boards do the way you've done. As they're required, we bring them forward one or two at a time. We bring them forward throughout the entire year. Some boards choose to do entire sections all at once. So it's really up to the board to determine how they want to visit the policy. And I'll speak a little bit more about policy later on. But that's the gist of it. We've also just started to think about the bus contract negotiation. I don't know if you recall, but the bus contract ends this June. And it's a collaborative, cooperative arrangement between the towns. So we are beginning to look at that. Brian will talk a little bit about that later in his agency report. We did complete the administrator's contract as well, and I believe you have that. And I hope you had the shift in enrollment report. This is based on no change, typically, and of course we know there will be changes in all of the budgets, or likely to be changes in all of the budgets. But this just will give Salisbury a sense of what is happening in the future. what you're paying now, what your assessments are. I think the key is shift in the percentages, and you can see that actually you're doing quite well in all of these areas.
Because we're going down.
You're going down. So for Salisbury, you went through a couple years of fairly high assessments, but it looks like in this particular percentage, you're doing better than I actually thought you were going to do.
Right, I thought that we were supposed to have a spike this upcoming year because of our last year's eighth grade class.
You would think that, but
I think so many of them went to prep school that it just ended up being moved.
Yeah,
and
just half of them went to prep school.
Yeah, it does happen.
Half.
So, you know, we looked at the rough numbers. So I just wanted you to have that for planning purposes. This will change a great deal. This is just a base for you to begin to think about as you talk to town folks. We have Grace Bristow that'll be recognized November 20th at the Litchfield County Superintendent's Award. Students are recognized, a student from each school and two from the high school are recognized each year for their academic scholarship as well as their civic responsibilities in school. So it's a well-rounded student, we hope, and one that the school has nominated. So we're very much looking forward to that. It's always a lovely event. I've already mentioned the bus contract. I think that's all I have for you, unless you have questions. There's a reminder about the CAVE conference. CAPS conference is coming up November 15 and 16. And that's in your packet if you have an interest in enrolling.
Let you know.
Right. I have this problem every year, and I'm sorry to be dense about it.
No.
Why? Oh, no, sorry, I just answered my own question.
Okay.
It's the enroll. I was trying to figure out why the percentages were different for the high school and for pupil services. The pupil services takes into account the high school and the elementary school,
and the
high school is only the high school.
Correct.
Sorry.
That's it. You answered it. It is complicated. It's not an easy formula to understand.
Are we going to talk about childhood obesity and exercise policy?
That's my.
I think that's.
We're talking.
Up.
It's actually the same as my policy, so we can talk about that under me.
It's coming up under old business, I think.
And is that related to the?
That's
shipment
that and my policy are. Yeah.
Same
they address the same issue. Okay. They're slightly different policies.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, so I'm actually up.
Jennifer.
All right. So in your packet, you have two things. You have this policy, 6142.10, which is called Health Education Program. And you have this Shipman and Goodman, from Patricia, you have the Shipman and Goodman policy, Goodwin policy. These both are in response to a new mandate from the state, Public Act 13-173, an act concerning childhood obesity and physical exercise in schools, which was effective October 1st. And it requires that elementary schools offer each enrolled student time devoted to physical exercise of not less than 20 minutes in total, elementary school, unless altered by a PPT for a child receiving special education services. And it contains a new policy requirement that says, boards of education must adopt a policy as the board deems appropriate concerning the issue regarding any school employee being involved in preventing a student in elementary school from participating in the entire time devoted to physical exercise. So basically, you can't punish a student by saying you can't go to recess. That's the bottom line.
I said that when I was here.
I'm just catching up with you.
I mean, So that's basically what the issue is. So we have to have a policy in place that does that. So we have two different ways of doing that. CABE modified two different health policy, health and wellness. One was physical activity policy and one was the health education policy. They had two different ones that are their recommended policies, and I picked the one that made the most sense to me, and that's this one that I sent. Patricia, and this is actually a comprehensive policy. We don't have this policy now, but we also don't need this policy, absolutely. Patricia draft policy deal only with not taking away that. So we can kind of decide. Lisa, did you have thoughts on this?
I think the one that you brought is more comprehensive in
Is it comprehensive and good, though, or is it comprehensive like, oh my gosh, I really don't want to have to do all this stuff? Do you know what I mean?
I think we do a lot of it.
So, okay.
When I read it,
I read it, and I didn't think there was anything that we're not, any big thing that we're not doing, but.
Well, what about in the middle school? This says
this deals with elementary school.
So that doesn't include.
Right, we don't have to worry about the fact that middle school does not have recess.
Right.
Yet, or
well,
they haven't in several years.
Yeah, no, I know that. I meant state-wise, are we going to be mandated?
I don't know. I think, I don't
think
know.
So, Claude, I
but
asked
it's
that
different.
Question. They said middle schools they felt were quite different, and so they were really addressing elementaries. I asked questions about what if a child is misbehaving on the playground during recess?
Right.
Can you discipline a child that's misbehaving and deprive them of a portion of their recess? And the answer was absolutely. The recess is like a classroom. If a child's inappropriate in the recess as in the classroom, you would treat them the same way. I was a little concerned that,
Right, that you'd have to, they'd have to be, have free rein at recess where they could continue to misbehave. But
does
recess
count as the physical activity, though?
Yes.
So,
that's all they get each
and
day.
And why is it different from middle school than what was their reasoning for?
I think that the attorney's commentary was the middle schools often in the state do not have recesses, but they have movement from class to class, and their physical education programming could be different depending on how they're scheduled. And they just didn't want to tackle that. They recognized that there were a lot of schools that do not have a recess in the middle school.
And we, when we did away with recess, we discussed it quite a bit, and Chris was very clear that recess in the middle school gave him a lot of headaches. There were a lot of problems in the middle school with kids, and it's not that the majority of kids went out and were very physically active. I mean, a lot of the kids tended to stand around and, get into trouble, hang out and get into trouble. So it wasn't in middle school, it was not a big physical activity for a lot of
kids. Agreed, but I don't know why suddenly recess and physical activity are necessarily the same thing. I mean, because of that, why not? I mean, kids can choose to do whatever they want versus having them actually be active.
He described it as the spirit of the law is intended to not punish children by removing what little recess time they have, I guess.
No, I agree with that. I'm just saying, why can't we encourage all grades to be physically active every day, not necessarily via recess, but have a structured activity every day, whether it be go out and play
sports,
handball or whatever, but have kids
lost
participate.
Time slot, though, completely in middle school.
Right.
You have to put that time back in. I have heard a lot of parents comment that, middle school parents saying that they really feel that that's missing in terms of getting their kids a break, fresh air, something that.
Right. Right. And I just find it interesting that it's, mandated for.
Yeah.
Do we have
a
copy of the
actual
legislation? Yeah. Because in Jennifer's edition, it says the new legislation doesn't spell out the type of activity. It could be recess or it could be PE. So,
yes.
Right.
And this says through grade 8 here in number 2. So.
But that says that you need age appropriate health education through
health
grade
education.
8. It deals with
and
different.
And physical education.
Right, which we do. And we have a nutrition instruction curriculum. So
but
we do
not daily. Okay, so this one's saying daily 20 minutes, and this one's not stipulating. Okay.
Well, this does stipulate. I mean, this only talks about the 20 minutes of physical education, and the health education program in this bigger policy talks about, all the other, a whole bunch of stuff.
And it's not
and so because they don't have gym every day. So you can't really use recess to discipline, which we normally don't anyway. I think that's the right thing to do.
Agreed, and I don't disagree with that. My point was only that they're saying that it's important that the elementary students have this,
yeah.
and and not the middle school. And I just found it interesting, why are they saying it's more important or less important for one group than another? If it's important, I mean, the childhood obesity doesn't just, you know, happen
start
in elementary
stop.
School and then stop, and it's a done deal. It's something that's a lifelong issue.
The statute calls for, to answer your question, I think there's interest in looking at obesity in many ways, but the state wide task force on childhood obesity shall be established by October 1st. So obviously they're forming a group to look to the future. It requires the board to create a policy concerning the disciplining of staff who deny participation in physical activity as a form of student discipline during the day. Changes the language regarding 20 minutes of physical activity from K-5 to elementary schools, because not all elementary schools are K-5 schools. So they changed the language to sort of generalize that a little bit. He did say that we can define elementary in our school. We can define it K-4, K-5, whatever it is. And the other thing that they're looking at is, and that's why I think, Jennifer, this is kind of interesting, we're looking at this in two ways. One is in the 5,000 series, because it's sort of student discipline.
That's the shift. Okay, now I see why.
The 6,000 series, the one Jennifer has, is about really health, wellness, and instruction.
Okay.
It's more about the instructional side of it. Mm-hmm. And one of the things Jennifer and I talked about, you could have both of these policies, because they're not conflicting with each other.
Right.
And you would have one sort of in the discipline side, the Shipman and Goodwin, and one in the health and wellness side. But I think there's a great deal of interest in childhood obesity. We do have to have wellness plans, and physical activity is important. And for a long time, you at Salisbury have been aware of it and working on it. You have an advantage over some of the schools in that if you're in the middle school, you have the hill to climb.
Which
sounds kind of silly, but it's really it's kind of a fresh air break.
Fresh air break. Well, I just got confused because they're being presented at the same time as opposed to this is a policy about discipline, period. And now let's move on to this. I was confused because it appeared that they were being presented sort of together as an
And they're consistent.
Right.
They're very consistent, and you may want to have both of them.
I mean, my initial thought was that we only needed one of them, but, you know, if people favor both of them, certainly.
Well, I'm just looking at this public act and wondering is it redefining recess as the time devoted to physical exercise, the 20 minutes a day? And if that's the case, you know, how do we ensure that every kid is physically engaged during recess? Do we have to? I just wonder what that means. Because I know there are the kids who just sit and talk.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And is that their 20 minutes a day of physical exercise required under current law? Is that a fulfillment of that?
Elementary school, that
gets crazy.
That 20 minutes, all grades are pretty active. Mm.
I mean, there are some,
they're pretty
Johnson. I think in that little school, more kids who run around.
More elementary.
I've changed my desk that looks out the window now, so I want, but there is a lot of activity on that playground. There are not too many kids.
Yeah, you're not worried,
even in the fourth and fifth grade, there are kids who are opting out and sort of sitting down there. They may not be up on the field playing football, but they're walking or they're doing something where they're active.
So to address Amy's point, there's nothing in the statute that mandates that we set up an organized physical activity during recess. I didn't go through the definitions to see, I guess I can look up the statute to see if we need to, but I think we're, based on CAPE's policy and based on this policy, I think we can, from the state's perspective, safely allocate 20 minutes to recess, tell teachers you cannot take it away as punishment for not doing your homework or whatever, and we're covered there. Mm-hmm. I think we are also not required to have 20 minutes of recess in the middle school. We're covered there. Right.
to say that we want to look at having 20 minutes of recess in the middle school is a big deal, and we would need to look at that separately. And we certainly, not me, you guys can look at that separately going forward if you want. And if you do want to, then maybe we just need to go with the Series 5000 policy because it doesn't say anything about the other stuff. And, you know, if you're going to want to make a lot of changes to the middle school, which is going to be, you'd have
to do some studying.
It would probably be expensive because you either have to take away a class in order to fit it in, or you'd have to extend the school day, which the teachers were not so, I mean, they were very excited about it last time we did it, but I'm not sure they're going to want to do it again so soon. What do you guys think? I mean, this was the first three for both of these, so we can do whatever, but I don't think we need to do second reads on both of them unless we decide that we want.
But there's nothing that prohibits a teacher from allowing a student to come during that recess time after lunch.
As long as it's not punitive.
Correct, to get help.
Yes, oh yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So a student has been absent and the teacher says, you know, Brian, I'd like you to come in. Could you come in and let's catch you up at lunch? They don't view that as punitive. They view that as helpful.
Right.
And that's not a problem.
I think it's interesting. I think this is I think the state is walking a very fine line here. I mean, there are times when the state has really made some very specific pronouncements, like, you know, in high school you cannot give exams before 8 o'clock in the morning, that they have later backed off from because they said, you know, that's honestly too specific and we don't need to be involved quite at that level. And I think this is one of those very fine in terms of, I mean, prescriptive and really right on the edge of something the state should be involved in. But we do have it, so we kind of have to decide what we want to do with it. So let's hear it. What do you guys think?
Well, as a chair of the Wellness Council, I like this 600 series policy on a quick read. These are some of the things, you know, we've been looking at.
600 or
6,000? 6,000. Agreed. Did you, Amy, because I know you really are oriented toward this, as you read this, geez, I won't even be around to shepherd this through.
Yeah, I know.
Nor will you be to shepherd this through.
I know.
So I handed out let's try and get it in good shape before we leave.
Well, we bring it back for another reading.
Do you have any other, as you did your quick read, did anything jump out at you as issues?
Well, only one that I know that the people on the council are real concerned about is not just low fat, but low sugar. Is one of the things that we hear a lot from parents in terms of nutritious food.
Mm-hmm. So low fat foods, low fat and low sugar.
Yeah, I know that would be one thing that if the committee were to look at it right now, that's something that comes up quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Lisa, did anything jump out at you? That you want me to type up the one that I've got it on my computer? Or Sue, I guess Sue has it on her computer.
I guess my only concern is that I'm assuming that if we are complying with, if we participate in the federal lunch program and that we're complying with their guidelines, that we're meeting the requirements.
The low fat, low sugar, low dairy, blah, blah, blah.
But I just don't want to add an extra sort of surveillance, because we already have a hard time with all of the record keeping that we have to do for the federal program.
So I think that would be, well, first of all, I think we could certainly put in here, you know, in that same paragraph, shall include nutritious food choices in line with our participation in the federal
I think that would be good.
Then if the Wellness Committee wanted to do something different,
yes,
that would be something
above and beyond
additional and separate. I think that could be in an administrative regulation rather than a policy.
I think that would be good.
Would that impair if we opted out of the federal program?
I was just going to say, why not just say, shall include nutritious food choices, period. So it doesn't matter where we're. I mean, rather than.
I guess if we
even if you opt out, Claude, that's a good question.
Right.
If you opt out, there's still going to be a fairly high standard guideline.
That's my concern.
Even if you opt out.
I'm just saying by putting that word in there.
No, it's a good point.
Hold us to the federal requirements for continuing that should we not want to.
And do we need to say, I mean, I think the reason to
say aligned with but not necessarily governed by, you know, or some sort of language to that, but
what
just to say that, that we are...
What standard we're using, rather than
yes.
having a committee come in and say, well, you're defining healthy as X, but I want to define
exactly.
healthy as Y.
That's exactly right. And we know that the federal standards, even if we're not completely happy with the program, the federal standards are headed in the right direction, or at least the direction that we would like to be going in. So I think that to have a benchmark would be good. And then if we choose to do something different, that's fine. But at least we all agree that that's the common standard.
And they are becoming more rigorous over time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I would imagine.
Consistent with?
Or
consistent
what's
with?
What's more loose?
Well, what do you want to say?
Or the consistent with the, yeah.
Well, without saying consistent with our participation, and we'll just say consistent
with
the
guidelines of the federal
health and food
program.
Healthy food, is that what it's called? Federal healthy food?
No, it's two different.
Right.
All right, so
I think the National School Lunch Program is what it really is called. The National School Lunch Program.
But isn't the...
I mean, that's the actual acronym that's on the state of Connecticut website. And
but
healthy food is a totally different...
Right.
But isn't that a higher bar?
Federal guidelines.
Well, healthy food certification has to do with
everything
other than regularly served meals.
Oh.
It's all the extra stuff.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. So let's say the National Lunch Program.
National School Lunch Program.
National School Lunch Program.
And healthy certification is what we go by is specific to Connecticut.
All right, so I'll rewrite that paragraph to say food and beverages sold or served in district shall include nutritious food choices consistent with the guidelines of the National School Lunch Program. Food and beverages sold and served in district shall include nutritious, low-fat, and low-sugar foods and drinks, which may include but shall not be limited to, blah, blah, blah. And then you guys can bring it back for a second read.
Okay.
Anybody have anything else on it?
Just the changes from superintendent shall develop administrative to principal shall develop.
Yeah.
And the board require that all district schools.
Yeah, there isn't that. Where's that?
The top of that page. The first sentence.
Okay, that SCS.
It comes up later too.
Yeah, it comes up later and I think all before right. as well.
Okay.
Number four.
Before when somebody brought up, or when Amy brought up the low sugar, I thought that you were suggesting we not say that.
No, I'm fine with that.
Okay.
That would be.
It doesn't say they all have to be low fat. We provide that as an alternative.
Okay.
There will be some low sugar alternative
too.
Right. Low sodium, low. I mean, are we going to stick with the others? Okay, somebody else.
On the first page, number four, is that does that include staff, or is that only regarding students?
This is a student policy.
School health programs should be designed to incorporate school health service activities that are designed to ensure access. I read that and I said, we have dental care that comes to the school. We must be in good shape.
You do.
But I don't know.
Prevent and control communicable disease and other health problems.
I mean, Mary Catherine sent stuff home with
advice. I would say that we
think about it. All students have to comply with state of Connecticut immunization guidelines.
So
that's
right.
Washing
hands.
Disease.
Yep.
Right. Just because in the very beginning it says schools cannot achieve their primary mission of education if students and staff are not healthy and fit physically, mentally, and socially. So I didn't know if that tied staff into it. That was...
Maybe just... I don't have any problem leaving that in.
I think it's a philosophical statement.
Yeah, I agree.
That's the way I read it.
Yeah.
I guess number three is the one that's very interesting and probably will be something the Wellness Council
districts,
will get.
Nutrition,
you know,
education.
Yeah, what are the food service activities? How do we define that? And how are they? Are they? Do we have a nutrition education curriculum that's formal? Right.
We do. It's ancient.
And is it actually
implemented?
In use?
Yeah, I think it is through rewritten units, Amy, but there is a nutrition program.
And I know that my kids have gotten some nutrition through, I don't know if it's SEI or something,
yes,
but how it is reading labels and, you know, looking at
that. Yeah,
in elementary school.
In elementary, this doesn't
say
that.
Donna does some work with that in middle school as well.
And I also think the school nurse has been fairly active in helping with nutritional programming. But I think what it tells us is we really have to look at our health. We really have to look at health. It's not an option to not have a health program.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, we should look at that and revisit it. It's been just lower on the priority list, mostly because of the sea of changes that we've had in curriculum.
There is a lot going on. All right, so if I could summarize, we are not going to pursue the 5,000 Shipman and Goodwin series for the moment. We will pursue 6142.10, and I'll make these comments and get them to Sue, and, you know, I'll be available as a resource if anybody going forward, whoever you convince to take on the policy work, wants to talk about it.
Excellent.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. ABC report. Last Tuesday, I attended down at Cornwall Consolidated ABC meeting, went over several things. The ABC unanimously voted to have Gary Brochu, the Region 1's attorney, look at the statutes in the 7,000 series, which we had talked about way back in August or September.
Remind me who Gary Brochu is affiliated. What's his firm?
Shipman &
Goodwin. He is Shipman & Goodwin, okay.
What was the exact directive? You know, when you said look at, was it more precise?
No.
Okay.
I don't have the actual motion, but it's basically to make sure, first, to make sure that the statutes are being followed by the 7,000
mm-hmm.
series, then to go through the 7,000 series and make sure that they're not.
That we're interpreting them correctly, or that we're using them correctly.
Right. Because there are inconsistencies, and there are gaps, and there are
gray areas
that it would be very nice to have laid out, either with a revised 7,000 series or to eliminate the 7,000 series and have a cooperative agreement between all seven districts, or figure out for shared services. Sam Herrick told us about the union contract. I had gone to that previous Region 1 meeting and request that the Region 1 board not ratify the contract. They did ratify the contract. So I just made a note that it should have gone to the ABC so that all the local boards could hear about it before it was ratified, because two of those employees are shared services employees. The bus contract, as Patricia mentioned earlier, expires the end of June of 2014. The one thing that I did not see when I looked through it is the Oliver Wolcott side. Because that's included, and I remember the last time there was something that I had a beef with in this, with the Oliver Wolcott one, before. But anyway, that was talked about, so the new board will have to work on that either individually or through ABC to have all seven boards do it as we did it as a unified agreement before.
On the bus contract, Patricia, last year something happened with the bus contract. Like Sam got it extended for a year. No, he discussed it and it didn't happen.
They were discussing an extension. Actually, it wasn't an extension.
It was a new contract.
That would be for 5 years with an additional 2 or 3.
It was actually like 7 in total. It was more than our typical 5.
But that didn't happen.
It got shot down by the attorneys.
We ran through the attorneys. As you recall, once we sort of reach an agreement, we run it typically through the attorneys just to check in. And it was a lease buyback agreement. And again, I'm not remembering the details, but it wasn't.
Yeah, Brian had a problem with that.
And it was complicated. It wasn't straightforward.
All right.
And the attorneys advised that we not do that. So we're going into our last year and we don't start negotiating now, we're likely not to have a contract.
Right.
The ABC made a motion to recommend hiring Mark Walsh, who's a contract consultant who worked on his previous contract 5 years ago with us, to have the Region 1 board pony up the $2,500 or so, to have him help us either renegotiate or set up a new contract or go out to RFP or whatever we need to do. Of course, the other thing that I was thinking about related to the bus contract was maybe you just don't have a bus. And maybe in terms of the, so they don't have half full of school buses.
Right.
And maybe you provide an incentive to families to not do it.
But we have to by law, don't we?
You have to provide it.
If you take
even
money.
If they opt out.
If they opt out, as long as you provide it, if they opt in. But instead of $250,000 or whatever we have in that line, if we spent $150 offering rebates, if people would sign off on it, maybe you only run one bus. Mm-hmm. Anyway. That's not really anything with ABC.
Brian's thinking outside the box.
Sam handed out the shift in enrollment that we talked about earlier. Members of the Athletic Director Search Committee are meeting tomorrow at 7 o'clock at the high school. It was discussed that basically instead of being a high school and middle school, the position really will just be high school. And we'll be able to consult with the elementary schools. So
and schedule, do the schedules, and but not the day-to-day. My sense is there's too much of a conflict to have the high school AD try to be at the local elementary school games, but they would set up the schedules and the referees.
Well, scheduling is kind of crucial.
They would do.
Well, a lot of the cancellations would probably go through the school secretaries.
They'll set up the initials and do all of that. We think they can do that. It's a paper task. It's a tedious task, but
and it's time consuming. Yeah.
So we hope that that goes with this high school position.
Scheduling. Isn't it like? Like last year, but we do the reverse?
No.
We were at your place this year, you come to our place.
It's a little
different. They play IMS, they play some of the Hotchkiss
Nerds teams,
Steiner
School. And sometimes schools have to combine forces because they don't have enough kids to fill the team.
And then the schedule has to be redone.
I don't think we were expecting that the AD would be in all the games.
Yeah,
because
right.
we budgeted a small amount, and it was basically for
scheduling was the
and hiring of coaches.
Right. That was the other thing.
Well, that's the other thing. Yes, hiring of coaches.
Would that be still done by that?
I think they would help, and they would help with that. I don't know that they're going to be out there necessarily recruiting coaches for them, but I know they would pick up the phone and help in any way. I think the other piece that we talked about them possibly doing was evaluating the coaches, mm-hmm. and it just seems that they're probably only going to be involved with middle school coaches if there's a problem with the coach, right. that otherwise they will just generically not be evaluating the coaches. So what would be terribly different than what you have right now would be they're not going to get out to the games and they're not going to be able to evaluate all the coaches mm-hmm. or the principals.
I thought part of it, though, is also to have consistency of sort of training or whatever so that by the time they got to the high school, they were better prepared or more aligned with preparation of what's expected.
And I think that can still happen because that's bringing people together for seminars, workshop planning. I think all of that can happen because it can occur during the day, the planning of it. It doesn't have to be all at the same time at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. I think that's where the committee's going.
I think to add to what Claude was saying, to also to make sure there's equity, you know, that the teams start practicing at the same time.
Right.
So that you don't have
they'll continue
teams that start practicing 2 or 3 weeks.
The CIAC regulations will still be, they still have to make sure that they are first aid, CPR, the concussion modules. Somebody still has to check the paperwork.
But that this AD would be able to do that for coaches and stuff. I mean, and that sounds like that would take a lot of the burden off of you if they were. Is that happening this year? Oh, it is happening this year. But this is the first year it's happening. No.
No, we have had that happening since the beginning of sort of the concept of a AD in the middle school. It happens through our office. I mean, we're looking at their paperwork. We're our support staff in central office is actually doing a lot of it, I'll be honest with you.
How do cancellations get handled? I thought someone had talked to me about that, but that was part of the concern.
They call our
The home team decides.
Decides. And the coach makes, has to be involved in that or not?
Oh, yeah, yeah, absolutely. The coach and
so they notify you through
Patty,
okay.
And Patty calls the bus company.
Got it, okay. So it's not a big deal?
No.
Okay.
Somebody calls the ref or umpire or whatever season it is.
Coaches.
Officials.
The coaches do that. That's, I think, right.
But that's only, I mean, we've only put money aside for this for a couple of years.
Yes.
So this has been going on longer than, I mean, like a year. But this has been going on for longer than that?
No, this whole thing started about 2 years ago.
Yeah.
I actually think Mike Croft does that.
I mean, I think they were talking.
He called the other day when a game got
canceled. Craig Tunsey initially did it for a very small staff that handled like $6,000 a year.
Oh, so even, okay.
Yeah.
At least for soccer.
Dave, do you have anything on that?
So
I believe it started in 2008.
2008, okay.
Craig Tunsey was the first
one. Craig was the first one. It was a small stipend of about $6,000 a year. I'm fairly sure he was there several years, so it started Jim about a year and maybe a half, not quite a half. And I think he's been sharing with the committee some of the lessons he learned along the way as well.
So I'm still confused about this. I'm not sure what we're talking about.
Well, I think it's largely going to be a high school AD.
Well, that's however, but the high school AD has been, that position was a point, whatever, six
right.
position. Yeah. So is it still going to be point six and middle school, or is it going to be full-time?
I don't think the committee's decided that yet, and it might depend on the pool. If the pool is such that they can hire, for instance, if it's not a teacher, they're not restricted to the salary schedule, for instance, this would be an example, and therefore you have a range of money that might be full-time, that might be a full-time person without paying more, so to speak. So I think the salary is going to be negotiable depending on the qualifications, the certification level, and who the committee picks.
So you can be an AD without being a certified teacher?
Yes, there are other certifications that are required in lieu of that, but yes, it is possible to do that.
And the schools, the elementary schools are not chipping in at all?
It's going well,
this, I mean, it's going like through the high school budget.
No, right. Through central office, right. We've got the $10,000.
Right now. You have exactly what you put in last year, because it was never taken out. It's about $10,000 worth.
Why did we put in if it was already being done since 2008? I'm just confused.
That's what I've been confused by, because we only put it in the budget
last year.
Was just when this new board started, when ABC started talking about the middle school.
Right.
I know they already had that committee before then.
Yeah, we had a
little. That was doing a search.
That committee sort of led to the gym days, terrible days. There was a prior AD. Yeah, there's been a prior, and I'm not sure whether it came out of our budgets. It had to have. I think there was just a $6,000 stipend in the budget, and we called it middle school AD. I'm not sure what year that started, but I can go back and figure out
last year,
how it was financed.
But has that person been helping with the scheduling?
Yes.
They've been doing this all along.
Yeah, that person has been, and so did the last. And there's been breaks in between where the principals have actually done it, and for a long time the principals actually built the schedules. And there's usually one principal in charge. Recently, Mike Croft has twice stepped up to the plate and volunteered to do that. So he's really been a lifesaver this year. But it's a lot of work for his staff. So, you know, we feel that this is a fair way to sort of distribute the cost. How much of the 10 we're going to need, we don't know until the committee gets a little further along in the process.
But quick survey to go over the history.
Yeah.
We paid six effectively through the shared services at some point in time. Principals took over doing a bit of it because it dropped off.
When that person left, I think the principals took it back on.
Okay, and then the committee formed, and then it came back to a $10,000 recommendation.
Sort of a, yes.
Last year.
Okay.
And the committee did form up to look at, as you said, uniformity of rules.
Right.
The schools did not have the same rules, so they were trying to bring a lot
together. Up the game and the idea of what we're going to do.
And so I think that happened, and then the $10,000 position evolved. actually, it was more. It was a 20,000 position initially.
Well, initially, they wanted a full-time middle school athletic director, and the committee came back to that. That's what I remember, Andrea Downs and Lisa McCullough talking about.
But Salisbury and North Canaan limited the amount of funding.
Correct. So we ended up from the 20 down to the 10 through a couple revisions. The handbook has been through a first year, looking at it now in terms of the second year, what worked in the handbook, what didn't. To Lisa's point, many of our small schools are now teaming together to form a team, which changes schedules around a bit, and where do they practice. And so there's some logistics, but the principals have done a nice job working that out together.
Anything else on that? Excellent. During the roundtable discussion,
that poor horse.
it was asked, how do we get the enrollment at the high school, and how to conduct the next budget process in order to avoid problems experienced this year. Mr. Bartram suggested an FOI presentation to be held for the all boards members in the region, which would be inviting all the boards and towns. And I would actually like to see if we can get Tom Hennick out to Salisbury sometime between November 5th and whenever we can get him out here for all of the new board members. December, I believe the town does its appointments for any of the commissions who would be expiring, so it would be a good time to do it instead of having to wait till January.
And who is he?
He's really the FOI commission. He's in charge of it, basically. He did a nice job for us. He's been here before. This is something that we should probably do annually. It's just one of those refreshers that are helping.
Yeah, he came out 2 years ago, almost 2 years ago. Claude went, Stephanie went, I went, I think. Ms. Chamberlain announced the elementary schools are struggling with the implementation of Power School, the tech positions, but we talked about that earlier tonight. We did go into executive session to discuss Gonzalez versus Tunsing litigation, of which I have nothing to report. And that was the end of the meeting. Any other questions about ABC?
They plan to re-meet, I think, early December.
Second week in December.
I get those dates to you so you have them. What I'll do is make sure that's in my November report for you, but I think their idea is to look, at what they want to do in terms of future budget talks and discussions, but they might also talk about what does the attorney have to say about the 7,000 series or the concept of a compact, whatever it is that, you know, I think they're interested in, very clear. So there is no argument or discussion or debate about the process or the any part of the 7,000 series, which is a shared service.
Is there a way for the ABC committee meetings to be sent to all board members?
We can broadcast
so that people know it's easy to miss the dates and be out looking at it. I think also to get board members perhaps to
heads up.
Well, the one thing that I also asked at that meeting is that for the next ABC committee in December to actually set a schedule for the entire year. Mm-hmm. So instead of having special meetings pop up, have it regularly scheduled, make it a monthly meeting, you know.
Yeah, but also that way we can participate in getting, you know, if there is need for public to be more involved in that, we can certainly help if we know in advance.
And I actually did that once and it confused people, but if people know that they don't have to be there, but they're welcome,
right.
You know, I think that's the message we have to send, because we sent it and people said, oh, do I have to be there? And so I think it's just if we're clear about it. We also post those all the time on our website, so you can find them there, as well as all the minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So you can actually go back and get a history of the group if you like.
My only point is that I think we do well, you give us information, we give you information to take there, and I don't know that all boards work in the same fashion, and it'd be nice that that communication stream is sort of more consistent.
Well, we haven't always done so much about that either. It's really only this year because it's a particular concern of Brian's and because the ABC has had more issues.
I think if ABC has more meetings that are regularly scheduled, I think that will be much easier to have on a calendar.
Mm-hmm. Although it might be, ideally you'd like to get it to where the ABC only has to meet quarterly, or, you know, maybe every other month, because just for your board chairs to have to go to all the board meetings and the school stuff and yet another, you know, it makes it a lot. If you could get it such that it was reachable.
But if it comes to the point that they are in charge of central office, it's probably important to meet more frequently than less frequently.
We'll work on it. We just need a
but
little time.
But that'll be for the next ABC then, to determine.
Other people to worry about.
Anything else on ABC? Board retreat. So this is for the continuing members. Are you interested in having a board retreat? Let it drop. You guys can decide when the new board is on. You're interested in doing it, and you should set something up.
Your idea is you mentioned doing it.
You do it in between the 5th and the 19th of November. When it's in transition, we could do that. We don't need to.
I think it's important to ask the new board members. They'd like to, probably.
Okay.
And I think Jeff, Claude.
I mean, we were just talking about doing like a dinner and evening thing, right? Or something?
Be whatever time it works out for us.
I thought it was like a Mohegan Sun or something.
This is going to go a mini retreat
I'll go for a massage. I'll see you later.
I guess if it were to be there, everyone would have to go to the cave conference.
In
have you ever done one before?
Yeah, we had one.
8 years ago.
Yeah, when I started.
I've never taken a retreat in Salisbury.
Yeah, a mini retreat.
Where was yours? We did it at Lake Robin.
I think it was.
Yeah, I remember it was good to get together and just sort of set goals and talk about things we liked and things we didn't like. Yeah,
it's
you
open
did.
To the public.
Did you have an outside facilitator or did you?
Who did we have?
No, you did not have an outside facilitator. I think we did. It's just sort of internally.
We didn't have what's his name?
I don't think it was fancy.
We did
not
have
that one, I don't think. John, you can go down with the Costa.
John.
I don't think so. No. I think Roger conducted a meeting and Roger went through. You know. I think Roger actually sort of led that. And
well, maybe we could hire Roger.
Roger could come back and do that.
Oh, he'd be good.
Yeah. Plus, it might be interesting to have your former chairs, even Coley did, and because I think they learn from each other. Mm-hmm. It might be interesting. Then it'll be fun to have you guys there because, again, I think you have much to learn from each other.
Mm-hmm.
Excellent. Okay.
Do you want to wait to decide or do you want to decide now?
If we decide right at our next meeting.
You'll have the new people on board.
Right.
But Brian was proposing doing it before that meeting. That's why I was saying, should we decide now or wait? I mean, I think we should wait.
Right.
That's fine.
Okay.
Would you commit now to be there, correct?
Wait.
No commitments after the 19th.
Might be leaving, yes.
New business.
That's me.
Patricia.
Thank you. It is my privilege and pleasure to honor our board members and the great contribution that each and every one of them have made to our children here at Salisbury Central. This is a service that sometimes is a thankless one. And just know from my point of view, and I know I'm speaking for Lisa and would have spoken for Chris as well, they couldn't do their jobs without the good work that you guys do for them. Jennifer has been on the board for 8 years. In that capacity, she has served us so well, particularly in the area of policy development. It was fun to work with her. I mean, it was easy. She made it easy for me.
Thank you.
I guess that's the best thing I can say. And we have a lovely book with her label on the inside, and it's Treasure Hunters.
I was hoping you'd do a fictional book.
And these books will remain actually here in the library.
Actually,
you'd like to check out.
Oh,
these are their copies.
Oh, good.
They actually will remain here in the library as well with the label and sign.
Who's that for?
Well, let me see.
Is that Green Eggs and Ham?
Recycling.
I'm not wearing fluorescent, though.
Step by step. And this is obviously an honor of Brian Bartram and his great work he's done here, not only on the board, but in helping our children understand the importance of recycling. You know, they start calling him Mr. Recycle around here. I'm getting nervous, but Brian, thank you so much.
Better not see that in the bin tomorrow.
Brian.
No.
Gotta take the cover off. Brian has been on the board for 9 years. He finished a term, if I'm remembering.
Yeah, for Gordy Johnson.
Dr. Johnson, and has served as your chair this last term. So Brian,
secretary for 4 years.
Well, and I just would like to add to that that Brian really never ever expected. I don't think you ever expected to be chairman, and
no.
Really did not want to be chairman. And I really am very grateful that he stepped up.
Yeah.
I didn't step back fast enough.
And took it on. And I think you did a great job.
I
and
do.
I thank you for that.
I do too. It isn't easy to chair a meeting. It's a different position. You know, you're managing the meeting, not just doing the business of the meeting. And Brian has done an excellent job. He is conscientious in every task that he's taken on, not only as a chair, but in working with all the different committees, the building committee, the safety committee. We're running over here and signing checks. I mean, I shouldn't even be telling you all this because we'll not get another chair. But and you heard the additional responsibilities of the ABC, and so it goes on and on. It's not a simple job. It's one that requires a great deal of leadership, and it is that leadership that he's provided us. So thank you.
Learn a very large amount of information those first couple of weeks becoming chairman.
Yes, you do.
Now you can go to the rocking chair.
So thank you very much, Brian. We very much appreciate you. And our next person is being honored is Amy Lake. And Amy has been with us 4 years. So she has served a term with us. And her book is The World Atlas. Because Amy is a really, truly a world traveler, but she's more than a traveler. She's a world learner and an educator of the world. And this she does so well. And I have the good fortune to see her in many different roles as a board member, as a teacher, and now we serve on a committee together, and I have an opportunity to be a colleague. And I have to say, she has so much to contribute and so much to offer. And Amy, thank you for giving us so much of your time.
It says it's your world, learn it, love it, explore it. That sounds just like
yes.
you.
And she is an explorer, that's right. So it's a
perfect. Oh, it's National Geographic.
It's perfect. So thank you, Amy.
Thank you.
It's been great working with you.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you all.
Thank you all. Thank you all. Thank you all. Thank you all.
Any other business? Being none, we have a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye. Opposed? Nay. We're adjourned. Thank you.